All right, Jordana, tell us who you are, what you do, and a fun fact.
Okay, I'm Jordana Zeldin. I am a sales coach, the founder of Spring Training, and I'm trying a new way of positioning myself on for size here. What I do is I help sellers and sales teams marry their values with their selling.
Okay.
Does that resonate? I don't know. Anyway, this isn't about me. My fun fact is I'm learning to play the ukulele.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, well, Larissa, top that.
Yikes. No ukulele playing over here. No one wants that. I am Larissa Haynes, the founder of Quivit Consulting, and we are talent optimization consultants, which is just fancy for saying all the people things. We use the power of people data plus self-awareness and EQ to drive culture, drive innovation, and basically just help people be better at work, feel better at work. So that's what I do. Fun fact about me is I would say the job that I got the most leadership training in was being a whitewater guide. I was a whitewater guide for a long time. And when you're pushing rubber down class 5 rapids, like you've got to figure out how to get people to listen to you and work together. So if you're, you know, looking for a summer job or you want some leadership training, go be a raft guide.
that's awesome. Amy.
Badass. I don't know how I can top ukulele and whitewater rafting guide, but so I'm Amy Quick. I'm a territory account manager at Fortinet. And I mean, I've been on this a time or two, but fun fact about me. Okay, I'll say something for the future. I am getting ready to move on to a 160-acre ranch in Texas. So I'm super excited about that. My horses will be right outside my window every morning. So that's, I'm looking forward to like being able to do some of these from the ranch, like maybe walking around showing everyone the wildlife. There's Bobby the goat. I'm sure he'll make an appearance, but that's a new fact about me, I guess you could say.
That's awesome. I can't wait to have a horse on 5 on Friday.
Patrick. Absolutely. It's happening.
That's awesome.
What's up, Patrick?
Not much, not a horse. That's my first intro. My name is Patrick Downs, co-host of the Customer Engagement Lab, sales enablement manager at Panadoc. Actually, just moved into a manager role today for our AE outbound team. So going back to holding a quota, back on calls, doing demos, excited to do that. Hopefully I can come on and actually pitch you guys soon because I'm going to have to get back into practice. That's going to be fun. Yeah,
excited to be here, John. I only had one week when I started at Fortinet. So the pressure's on next week. It's going down.
Appreciate that, Amy. Thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Yeah, let's do
You're
it.
Welcome. No fun fact? You're just handing it over to Haithem?
Oh, fun fact. Besides my squid, I actually am a poet. If you go to my Medium, there's like 150 poems on there. That's what I do to, you know, release all the emotional tension from the week. And I'm not really good at like long form writing. So I'm like, hey, if I could stick to like a paragraph or two, I can usually figure it out.
Do you write poems about sales?
Oh, no. No, that would be hell.
No sales haikus.
Very short, yeah.
Good to see you, man.
Oh, shit, I actually do.
Oh, God.
I forgot about the sales haikus.
Love it.
So my friend, tell us about yourself, who you are, what you do.
Yeah, sure thing. Thanks for having me in here. My name is Haithem. I help people become better persuasive communicators, which can translate into sales, helping you find a job, helping you progress within your career, things of that nature. Fun fact about me, recently I have been taking acting classes. I don't know if I'll ever become an actor, but it's definitely helping me in sales and in communication in general. So that's been fun.
Love it. All right, Jonathan, you're on the hot seat. You've been here before, you know the format. We're happy to help you out today. Tell us, for sure, tell us who you are, what you do. You gotta throw a fun fact and then let's get into it.
Cool. Yeah, my name is Jonathan Mahan. I am a sales representative based in Colorado, hence the background picture here. I'm currently working at a company called Security Scorecard. I guess fun fact, I'll go kind of in line with some other folks. So actually, Haythem, I took an online acting course over the fall as a way to sharpen my sales skills. And I can say it definitely helped. I feel like if I had, you know, put even more time into that, I probably would have even done even better. But even just with a little bit I was able to do online was awesome. And Jordana, I'm not learning to play the ukulele, but I am learning to play the piano right now. So kind of in that same boat as well. That's kind of my early morning before work, like wake up my mind type of routine as I play a little piano.
Super. Cool, man. Well, I know you sent that video to us, but remind us like the format you'd like to use today and how we can give you some feedback.
Yeah, absolutely. So where I'm at right now is when I was at my last company, I spent some time actually being on the receiving end of some software demos for the first time. And it was very eye-opening because they were boring as all get out. And it was like the most empty, lame part of my day. And I just couldn't wait for it to be over. And I dreaded having to go through another one. Like, if you're not careful, software demos are so boring. And like, it's interesting. I noticed that, like, I swear, if you were to like measure my brain activity during that hour, my brain was like almost in sleep mode. And I was like, all right, how are they possibly going to convince me of anything? How are they going to get my attention? How are they going to get me excited? How am I going to remember any of this when literally my brain activity is just settling down to almost nothing, right? So I thought to myself, okay, how do we reverse that? How do we make it so that this hour is the most interesting hour of their day? How do we make it so that this hour they're with me, their brain is actually lighting up so that memories are being encoded better and impressions are being made? Like, how do I present stuff to capture human attention, to capture curiosity, to make them lean in and cock their head during the demo rather than just like passing out and checking emails because it's so boring? So I started kind of thinking along those lines. And actually this started like last fall at my last company. And then when I got here, I finally had a chance to really give it a shot and test it out. So I'm fairly new to Security Scorecard. I've been here like a month, I'd say. So I've gone through my training, held a couple of sales calls, but still pretty early on. So what I'm hoping to do here is present to you guys kind of my pitch the way I would in a customer call. And you guys can tell me what about it is good and needs to stay and what about it needs to go and maybe what was missing, because already I've like done this maybe twice in the wild and I have a few ideas for how I want to make it better, but I'm not quite there yet as to what that V2 is going to look like. This is still V1, right? So as far as context for this call, there's already been a discovery call that happened in the past, spent 30 minutes digging into pains and needs and stuff like that. This is kind of the deeper dive. This is what we would probably call the demo, although there's going to be more in-depth demonstration of the platform in the future. But this is kind of their first taste of the platform. And in this conversation, I really like to focus on the difference between us and our competitors, because it is, like many industries, a very competitive industry. So that's kind of the purpose of this demo here, is to help them understand what makes us different and why it's important. And again, I'm trying to do it in such a way that really keeps people interested. So if somebody can volunteer to be the customer, I'm not going to need much from you because we've already done the discovery, but just someone to ask a few tie down questions to and to kind of role play the agenda setting for me.
Who wants to volunteer?
I'm happy to do it.
All right, let's do it. And then after that, obviously we'll go around and give you feedback. So do you want us to pause or stop you, or you'd rather kind of get through it and then us give you feedback after?
I think I'd rather go through it and get the feedback after. So just take notes. The pitch itself is probably like 35 minutes, right? Long, maybe 40 minutes. So yeah, that'll set aside, you know, still have a good, you know, 20 minutes or so at the end for feedback.
Super. Cool. You can share your screen as well.
All right, cool. All right, Jordana. Well, thank you so much for hopping on the call. I'm definitely glad we're having a chance to speak today. We have an hour set aside for this. That should be plenty of time, but just so I'm aware, do you have a hard stop at the end of this?
Yeah, I do. Thanks for asking.
Cool. All right. Perfect. Yeah, like I said, that should be plenty of time for us. Well, anyways, as far as, you know, our time together goes, this is today is our chance to really take a deeper look at the Security Scorecard platform, and in particular to learn what about it is different from what you might find in the marketplace. I know you mentioned you were evaluating BitSight and UpGuard as well. So I'll spend some time talking about, you know, some differences in the way we've gone about setting up our product compared to what other folks have done. Generally, I find in these conversations helpful if the first half of the conversation, I just start by sharing with you what I found is the most important information for you to know about our service. Some of the things I share with you will be actual visual parts of the platform, and I'll do a screen share and show you that. Some things will be more discussions about what's happening under the hood, so to speak, right? Aspects of the platform you wouldn't necessarily see just logging in. And then I'm going to set aside a good chunk of time there for questions of yours, whether it's questions that we didn't cover or even factors that you want to dive deeper into. And then basically we just got to make sure we leave at least 10 minutes at the end for us to really have a conversation about what we're each going to need to be able to work together. And then also plan out what the appropriate next step would be, which more than likely will be a test drive of the system next week, but we'll kind of discuss that when that comes there. I'm curious though, what else were you hoping to accomplish in our time together today?
That sounds really good. Yeah, really thorough.
Cool. Fantastic. Well, so let me get started here. And I'll tell you right now, rather than just spending the next hour dumping information on you and features galore, what I'd rather do is I'll talk to you about our platform through the lens of 5 specific problems that we've run into and that our customers have run into over the last number of years we've been doing this. And I'll do that for 2 reasons. First off, I think a lot of these features will make more sense to you when you understand the problem they were designed to solve. But the other reason I'm doing it this way is that these 5 problems we ran into are the exact same 5 problems any company who's a cybersecurity risk rating tool would run into. Meaning that the BitSites, the UpGuards of the world, the other companies you're looking at, they've run into these 5 challenges too. And you as a consumer need to know how they've addressed these 5 challenges in order to make a well-informed decision about what company you want to work with. So of course I'll share with you how we've addressed these 5 challenges, but I also encourage you to find out how any other option you're looking at have addressed these challenges as well. Does that sound good?
Yeah, I'm very interested in this.
Cool. Well, these 5 problems, they each have parallels in other areas of life too. So the names I've given for them is the blood pressure problem, the cookie dough problem, the phone booth problem, the organic problem, and of course, the asteroid problem. So we'll take these one at a time. First off, the blood pressure problem. I would say the blood pressure problem could probably both best be said this way, is that whenever you're monitoring a situation which is likely to change on short notice, you need to do very regular assessments. However, when the resource cost of doing an assessment is high, you'll never be able to do as many assessments as you need to. And you're just gonna have to accept a certain level of uncertainty in the space between assessments. So that might be a little vague. So here's a real example, right? Let's say you go to the doctor's office and they tell you, you got high blood pressure. And they want you to come in every 3 months instead of every year. While that's definitely an improvement, you got to recognize blood pressure can change from month to month, from week to week, heck, even day to day. So when you're doing assessments every 3 months, you're missing a lot, right? Could get an assessment in April and one in July, but spend a lot of that time between April and July in that danger zone where you're in risk of a stroke, but neither you or your doctor would ever know because you're only doing assessments every 3 months. But what are you supposed to do about it, right? Go to the doctor every day, every week? Like, this is not realistic because the resource cost of going to the doctor to get your blood pressure checked is fairly high. So in the world of a cybersecurity risk rating service, we run into essentially the same issue, which is that, of course, the cybersecurity posture of an organization can change from day to day, week to week, and month to month. So you want to monitor it very regularly. However, when the process of rating a company's cybersecurity posture is resource intensive, you can't do the assessments as often as you'd like. So what do you do about this? Well, in the situation of blood pressure, it's pretty simple. You buy a little armband that syncs to your Apple Watch. They make those these days, and you can actually check your own blood pressure in 60 seconds, right, on your lunch break. So what's happened in that case is that the resource cost of an assessment has become almost nothing, which means you can do the assessments every single day. So let's actually take a look at what that would look like thrown up on a graph. So if you go to the doctor, 4 times a year, those are the red dots, right? And that's where your blood pressure was at during those 4 assessments. And the blue dots represent every single day you're taking your own blood pressure. And as you can tell, there's a lot of that story that's captured by the blue dots that's missed by the red dots. So what about the cybersecurity world? Well, it's basically the same idea. You need to shrink the cost of an assessment. You need to make it so that the resources involved in doing a score for a company is almost nothing, which means you need to remove the human component. And that's something that none of the other options on the market have been able to do yet. If you ask any of the other companies out there how they produce their score, they'll all tell you the same thing. There's a lot of computer and software assisting, but at the end of the day, it's a human being who finalizes that score and does that attribution, which means they're in that blood pressure problem where they can only do the assessments so often and they can only monitor so many companies. What Security Scorecard has been able to do is get machine learning algorithms and artificial intelligence systems that are so good, we can get to just about the same level of accuracy as a human being can with no human being involved, which means the cost of an assessment is basically nothing. So we actually update scores every single day rather than on a monthly or every 90-day cadence. So this gives us a number of advantages. And I'll actually show you some of the platform here to show you kind of what the advantages look like in the platform. But I'm curious for you, if you knew that, or pardon me, if there was a significant change in the cybersecurity risk of one of the partners or vendors you worked with, how long would you be comfortable being in the dark about that change?
I mean, ideally, I'd like to know right away.
Most folks would as well. So let me actually hop inside of our platform and give you an idea of, you know, how fresh the data is on our end. All right, so here is a random portfolio. Let me grab this company here. They've got a C. So here we're looking at some of the different factors, right, for their cybersecurity health. We'll go ahead and open up one of these factors to go a little bit deeper into it. And we're looking here at what's called the forensic level data. And what we can see here is what issues were observed. And notice the last date observed, right? In this case, it was May 12th, right? That's less than 2 weeks ago. A lot of the issues that we were to look at, if we looked at them, we'd probably find issues that were found, you know, within the last couple of days. Let's see, here we go, May 15th, right? Less than a week ago. So what I'm showing you here is that the data on the platform is very fresh. Because we're doing scans every single day, whenever something changes, it usually is only a couple of days before it shows up on the scorecard and you're able to see it on your end. Now, that is kind of the thoroughness advantage we have because we're able to do these scans without a human being involved. There's also advantages we get in scale, which we'll cover next. And there's also advantages in speed. And let me actually show you two examples when the speed would matter to you. So the first one is, you know, every so often, seems like these days more often than it used to, there are announcements of major breaches, right? Whether it's the SolarWinds incident, or maybe it's, you know, major vulnerabilities that have been detected. Just like, what was it, 2-3 weeks ago, the Pulse VPN vulnerability was announced, and that was like a, you know, 10 out of 10 severity. So when these things happen, I'm sure the first question that comes to your mind is, I wonder if any of our vendors and the companies we work with are susceptible to this new vulnerability. Well, because our system has the advantage of not being human-driven and rather being machine learning AI-driven, we can actually reverse engineer that vulnerability, do a scan of the entire IPv4 space in just a matter of number of hours, and then right away have a filter available that you can use to check and see if any of the companies you work with are susceptible or not. So good example is, I'd say the most recent major one was that Pulse VPN vulnerability. So you could pull up your portfolio of companies that you work with, and right here, there's going to be a filter. And within usually about a day of a breach or a vulnerability being announced, you'll find a filter here you can use to scan your current portfolio against. So one thing I would ask, if you're looking at other companies, is ask them how long it took them to have a filter in place for the Pulse VPN vulnerability. Did it take them a couple of days? Did it take them a couple of weeks? Or maybe do they still not have that feature available? Again, for us, we can usually do it within a matter of hours. So I would be comfortable telling you within 24 hours of a breach happening or a vulnerability being announced, you'll have that information. And one more example of when this speed matters to you is, let's say you're working with a company who's a fairly small vendor and your risk rating service, whether that's us or BitSight or UpGuard, has never rated this company before. But you, of course, want to get information on their security posture. How long is it going to take to get that information back? Well, just, you know, industry standard. And when I say industry standard, I mean standard amongst the rating services that are out there, such as us and BitSight and our other competitors. The industry standard is measured in weeks. Some companies will take them 6 weeks. Some it'll take them 2 weeks. Some companies, if they're trying to impress you and win your business, may be able to get it done in a week. For us, if there's a company who's never been rated yet, we can get a company in our system in 10 minutes. In 10 minutes, you'll have a score on that company. That'll be like basically 90% of the data we gather will be there available to you. The last few data points will trickle in over the next couple of days. So we call it a provisional score at first, but that score will be available to you within 10 minutes time. So you can immediately know where you stand with all your vendors, even if they've never been scored before. So again, that's another advantage of the speed that we are able to get because we've eliminated the human component from our system. All this making sense so far, Jordana?
Yeah.
Perfect. All right. Well, the second problem that we've run into as a company is what I call the cookie dough problem. Now, here's a scenario, right? Imagine it was your job to evaluate somebody's risk of getting sick over the next 12 months. And you find out they had a habit of eating raw cookie dough. Well, we all know you're not supposed to do that, but the question is that really a risk? And how much of a risk is it? And how much weight should you give that? So the cookie dough problem has to do with separating signal from noise and attributing the proper weights to various factors and doing all of this in a world that's constantly changing, right? Imagine that, you know, you determine the cookie dough eating habit isn't that much of a risk, but then there's a major salmonella outbreak in one of the major egg distributors in the country. Well, suddenly this cookie dough eating habit now suddenly matters more, right? So it's similar in the world of cybersecurity ratings. There's a whole ton of things that companies are supposed to be doing. No company is perfect as far as their security posture, but our job isn't to act as some kind of university professor grading your cybersecurity against a textbook standard of perfection. Our job is to assess the real world likelihood of breach that exists because of these signals. And how do you decide which signals should carry how much weight in that rating? Well, just like if you're trying to assess the risk of getting sick from eating raw cookie dough, you need a large sample size to answer this question, right? You can't just go ask your neighbors around the block if they've gotten sick from cookie dough and make your decision that way. Similarly, as a cybersecurity risk rating agency, we need a very large data sample of companies who are continuously monitoring in order to be able to assign proper weight to different factors and to continue to adjust the weights given as the world changes, right? Because of course, you know, the top correlations with breach in 2015 may not be the same things that are top correlations with breach in 2020, right? The world changes, the sophistication of, you know, bad actors changes, even the protocols that the internet is based on sometimes can change. So in order to solve this problem, what we've had to do is drastically increase the number of companies we're monitoring. So just for a benchmark, right? Industry standard is most security rating services out there are continuously monitoring between 100,000 and 200,000 companies. BitSight is companies that actually been around in the game a lot longer. They're continuously monitoring about 500,000 companies at any given point in time. And Security Scorecard, due to the fact that, as I mentioned before, we've removed the human component from our monitoring, is able to do quite a bit more than that. As of right now, we are continuously rating over 5 million companies. So the data set we're working with is a lot more robust. So we're able to give proper weights to different factors. And as the world changes, we'll be the first ones to notice those changes rather than the last. All right, so that's the second problem. Now, the third problem we've run into, I'll tell you right now, is a problem we haven't fully solved yet. No one has. It's still a problem that exists. So it's very important for you to know about. And that problem, let me go ahead and throw us back in the screen share mode here. That problem I call the phone booth problem. So in the 1960s, there was a Russian ambassador who is believed, if not confirmed, to be working with communist spies here in the US. So as you can imagine, the FBI was monitoring his phone lines, looking for suspicious activity. And one day, such a suspicious phone call came in. It was a payphone in Des Moines, Iowa. But the agent who went to investigate found out from a nearby shop owner that literally dozens of people used that phone on any given day. So the situation the FBI was in is they knew this device had engaged in, you know, we'll say problematic behavior, but they didn't necessarily know who was controlling that device at the time. And of course, this is very similar to the problem that we run into when we're monitoring cloud-based IP addresses, right? So in the world of cloud computing, a single, you know, server and a single range of IPs may be used by a number of different companies in any given month or any given week or any given day. So on the outside, we can tell you with confidence that this IP address engaged in, again, problematic behavior, but it can be a lot more difficult to pin down at the time that behavior was happening, what company was assigned to those IPs and was using those IPs. And this causes an issue we call misattribution. Also, people call it false positives. And the way you'll experience this is this: you'll log into your scorecard, or one of your vendors will log into their scorecard, and they'll see that they've been dinged for something. But then you'll look up that IP address and realize, hey, wait a minute, that IP address isn't ours anymore. And it's still on our scorecard, and we'll still get dinged for it. And that shouldn't be. So this is an issue you will experience regardless what company you go with. It's just the nature of the internet right now and the nature of monitoring right now. So my first question to you is, in your organization, if you were to actually find a bunch of these suspected errors, who on your team would take the point, take lead on tracking those errors down and working with us to get them off your scorecard?
Oh God, that would probably be our head of IT, I guess.
And how much is the head of IT's time worth to the company?
A lot. He's already, he's already putting out fires all over the place. So
yeah, Definitely. So with that in mind, when you're looking into a cyber risk rating tool, the two questions you need to ask on this is, what is the error rate, right? We talk about 20%, 10%, 5%. And you also need to ask, what does the process look like for cleaning up those errors? Is it something that takes a long time? Is it quick? Is it something that's a very arduous, drawn out process? Or, you know, is it something that is, you know, a very light lift? Because you got to understand, and this topic will come up again, but the cost of a system like this partially is the cost you pay up front for the software, but partially is the cost, usually measured in resources and man hours, the cost of actually deriving value from the platform, right? So you have to ask these questions. So I'll actually get to Security Scorecard's answer for that in a second, but just know those are the questions to ask. What's the error rate and what's the process look like for cleaning up those errors? All right, we'll actually move on to the second, the fourth problem. And the solution for it kind of ties into the solution for this third problem. So the fourth problem we ran into is called the organic problem. And this slide here is actually inspired by a trip to the grocery store my wife and I took back, you know, in the days when you went to a grocery store instead of doing Walmart pickup. And we were considering raspberries, and we saw the organic raspberries and the normal raspberries. And we thought to ourselves, does that rating actually mean anything in real life? So we did some research online. And while I can't really tell you it's conclusive, I can tell you there's a lot of people out there who don't trust that organic stamp. They don't trust that that rating is actually means the food is better for your body or better for the planet. And the lesson we get from the organic rating is that the good of a rating service, or a rating service, is only as good as the faith the marketplace has in it, right? I'm never going to spend extra money on organic raspberries again after doing that online research, because now I don't believe that rating means anything. And as you can imagine, that's a major problem for us as a company, how to command the faith of the marketplace that our ratings actually mean something. But it's also a problem for you for two specific reasons. One simply is that if you're going to spend money on our platform, right, $100K a year, whatever it ends up being, you want to know the data is good. And similarly, if you're going to be making business decisions based on our data, you want to know the data is good. But it also matters to you because you want your vendors to take their score seriously. Because here's what will happen, Jordana. You got 60 vendors. You'll send out, you know, let's say there's 20 of those vendors who have a score you're not happy with. So you'll reach out to those 20 vendors and say, hey, you've got a D in the platform. Can you work on this? And most of those organizations are probably under the impression that they have good cybersecurity. So when they see they have a D, they're going to say, what are you talking about? Says who? Says Security Scorecard? Well, what do they know? I'll bet you that rating service is garbage, right? A lot of people, when they see they have a bad grade, their gut reaction is skepticism and disbelief that that grade can be true. And trust me, you're not going to have much luck getting your vendors to work on fixing their score if they don't even believe the score means anything. So you need to have a rating service which commands the trust of the marketplace. Well, how do you get trust becomes the next question, right? What we found is that in this area, as really with any area of business or life, trust comes from transparency. So as a rating service, if you want trust, you need to be transparent on where your data is coming from, on how accurate your data is. You need to be transparent on what your scoring methodology is, right? So people understand where this number comes from. You gotta be transparent on how long it takes to fix issues, right? You need to share that with the world if you're gonna command trust in the marketplace. Before going further, would you agree with what I just said? And I'm curious, if you were evaluating a security ratings tool and you found that they weren't transparent about those things I just described, would that bother you?
That would be a problem. Yeah.
I think so too, right? So that's why Security Scorecard launched our trust portal. So let me go ahead and pull that up. We actually saw this briefly just a moment ago, but this is our trust portal. Anyone in the world can access this webpage. It's just trust.securityscorecard.com. And it lays out in full detail for everyone to see this white paper. This white paper here shows where we get our data from, how often we're checking each data source, how long it takes for, you know, issues to decay off a scorecard. We're showing what formula we use for calculating weights, right? We're showing literally everything you'd want to know about our tool and how our scores are generated right there in a public white paper. We also had an independent test done by pen test experts. Particularly, we had them focus on the error rate, the misattribution rate. That's what we mentioned just a moment ago. You can read this report here in full detail, or I can just give you the summary and tell you that our IP attribution rate was 95% accurate and domain attribution was 100% accurate. So it's laid right out there for the whole world to see. In fact, this is kind of, you know, maybe a historical look of what the past was like. Since then, we've done a lot of improvements, particularly around how often we scan cloud-based IPs. So we have fewer errors than we had even back then. So what we do now is we actually share our current error rate. So this is our actual misattribution rate on a rolling 7-day basis. And like I said, we made a lot of improvements. So now this is usually between 1% and 2% error rate is what we find. So all that is laid out here publicly for the world to see. And if we go back to those two questions I told you to ask, right, what is the error rate? So in our case, when it was measured by third party last year, it was 5%. We've made improvements since then. So now it's closer to 1% or 2%. That's our error rate. And the other question I told you to ask is how long does it take to resolve those errors, right? And what's that process look like? Well, again, just so you have some context, industry standard is to have this remediation process take a number of weeks, maybe 6 weeks, maybe it's 4 weeks, maybe it's 12 weeks. Every company is a little different there, but most companies will have your errors removed within a matter of weeks. Our service level agreement with our customers is to have these errors removed within 48 hours. And in fact, in this trust portal, we have a real-time dashboard showing our actual remediation time over the last 7 days. So over the last 7 days, we've actually been more like 14 to 18 hours. I can tell you usually we're between like 20 and 30 hours for that resolution time. So this means that your head of IT, who you said their time is very valuable to the company, is not going to have to spend a whole lot of time cleaning up this data. Within a matter of days, each issue will be taken care of. So I'll bet you within a few weeks, this whole thing will be taken care of and behind you. And you can have good data to work with in that amount of time. Gotta take a drink here. I'm in Colorado and like it's really dry air. So it means I have to like be constantly guzzling water during these. All right, so if you're keeping score, we're four problems, right? So what is this fifth problem? Well, the fifth problem was the asteroid problem. So imagine this, right? Imagine you're watching the evening news and we find out that an asteroid's heading towards Earth. It's gonna wipe out all life on the planet in 12 hours time. Well, I would wanna know, but the question is, are we really any better off for knowing that? So the lesson of the asteroid problem is this. If you alert someone to the presence of a threat, but don't give them any real world path to actually reducing that threat, all you've really done is given them anxiety. And as a cybersecurity rating service, this is a real risk for us, right? If all we do is we show up and we tell you that, hey, you've got 20% of your companies with a bad score, but then the process of working with those vendors to improve those scores is so difficult and complicated and arduous and time consuming that neither you or your vendors have the bandwidth for it, then what have we really done for you, right? We've just given you anxiety. You're not actually any better off. So actually a lot of our platform has been specifically designed to resolve this asteroid problem and to make it a smooth and easy process to get these issues taken care of. So let me jump back into screen share here real quick, and I'll actually show you just a couple of those features that are really relevant. All right, so let's go ahead and just open up the portfolio here. All right, let's grab any one of these companies. All right, well, let's grab one with the lower score, usually makes for a better one. Let's see IPG Photonics. All right, so they have an F, right? So you see this and you go, okay, well, that's clearly not okay with us. You can dig in here a little bit further to see the issues if you want to. But honestly, there's a lot of issues. It's kind of overwhelming. It's a lot of information for you to consume. It's a lot of information for your vendor to look at. So let's say you want them to improve their score. Well, what you would do is you'd use this blue proposal score plan right here. And you would simply set, you know, what you wanted that bar to be. So let's say you want them to get to a B, and then you generate the plan. And there's two ways to generate the plan. One is what people usually do, which is basically our system just tells you how to get from this score to that score in the fewest number of steps. So this is the automatically generated score plan, just tell you what to fix and what's priority. The other thing you could do is you could kind of adjust it manually, right? So there's the adjust my plan button in the top. You could adjust it manually and say, okay, well, I actually don't care a whole ton about the site not enforcing HTTPS, but I'm really concerned by this outdated web browser. And you could make those adjustments on your own and kind of manually produce the scorecard. But this basically lays out a very concise, clear plan of action of, in order to get from here to there, here's exactly what needs to be done. And you can use this for your own company, but you can also download this and share it with one of your vendors. So they have a very clear plan of action of what you want them to improve. Now, to be honest, if it stopped there, that would only be so helpful, because here's what would happen. You send the score plan over, your vendor would look at it and say, outdated web browser observed. What do you mean? We're up to date. 20 instances? What are you talking about? We don't have that many. And then what would you have to do? You'd have to go here into the platform. You'd have to dig up, the endpoint security, and you'd have to say, okay, where are these outdated web browsers? You'd have to take screenshots for them, everything you're seeing on this page. You'd have to send it their way so that they could track it down. Basically, you'd be put in a position of being middleman here between the data we have on the company and the company who actually needs to resolve it. Jordana, if you were in this position where you had vendors who had a not so great score, would it be that director of IT who worked with them, or is there someone else on the team who would work with these vendors to improve their score?
It would be the director of IT again, yeah.
Cool. Who, again, we already established their time's worth a lot to the company. And I'm sure there's better things they can do with their time than run around playing middleman for these vendors. So what you would want to do in that case is actually invite the vendor to the platform for themselves so that they can see these issues and they can resolve these issues on their own. So, right, here's what that would look like. Let's say you're looking at a company, you want them to improve their score. Right here, there's a blue invite company button. Now, here's actually where there's a very big difference between the way Security Scorecard does things and the way other companies does things that bears a little bit more time. So industry standard out there for, I think, every company other than us is that they charge for the third-party risk management side of the platform, and they charge for the self-monitoring side of the platform. Meaning that when you send an invitation to one of your vendors to come check out the platform, they'll get a small window in the beginning of, you know, whether it's 30 days or 90 days or 14 days, they'll get a small window in the beginning that they can look at their score for free. But if they're not able to clean up all the issues in that limited window of time, then they hit a paywall and they can't see anything anymore. And the moment that happens, you get thrust into the role of middleman. And any vendor you want to work on issues with, you have to be the middleman, which is going to be, as you can imagine, a major drain on your time and your resources. And basically, these vendors that you invite to the platform become a cost center for you. However, those same vendors who are costing you a lot are actually making a profit for the ratings company. Because when you invite 60 vendors to the platform, some of them are going to buy it, right? Buy that self-monitoring use case. Not many, but some of them will. So this business model, which makes the rating service a lot of money of charging for the self-monitoring, is actually costing you a lot because you have to play the role of middleman. One Security Scorecard realized that, and our customers brought that to light. We actually changed our policy on this and started offering the self-monitoring to every company for free forever in full detail. What this means is that there will be absolutely no reason for your vendors to ask you to be middleman, because there is nothing that you can see on their company that they can't see on themselves. They got the same exact data you've got. And it stays this way forever. So you will never have to be the middleman when you're using Security Scorecard. Your vendors can see the issues on their own. In fact, we take it a step further. It doesn't happen often, but from time to time, you'll have a vendor who gets really confused, really turned around, doesn't know what to do in the platform. They get frustrated and they express as much to you. Well, we don't want you to have to spend your time working with them. When that happens, you can reach out to your CSM, right, who's a support person who works with you on a regular basis, and tell them you have a vendor who's all confused. And this CSM will actually reach out to that vendor on your behalf and do a quick training and show them what needs to be done. So on our end, we aren't making any money off your vendors. In fact, it costs us money to support your vendors, but we're happy to do that because that saves you from having to be middleman, and it makes it so that you can get a lot more value out of the platform. But as you can imagine, right, that will create a difference in the upfront cost you pay for the service. While our list prices are the same, our competitors will drop ridiculously low on pricing because they know they can make money off your vendors. So they don't even necessarily need to make much money off of you. We don't have the flexibility, right? I can probably give you a little bit of a discount if we negotiate, but in the end, you'll find that we're always going to be costing you more than our competitors do. And this is one of the major reasons. But again, I return to that point I made earlier that when you're evaluating a tool like this, you have to compare the cost you pay upfront for the service, but you also have to compare the cost that you actually incur from using the service. And again, that cost is usually monitored or measured in man hours and time like that. So that is, I think, most of what I was going to share with you. I would say the final thing that we heard from customers sometimes limited their ability to take action on what they learned was just simple resource constraints, right? A lot of times IT departments are, expected to deliver Porsche results on a Ford focused budget. And though you may be aware of the issues, if you don't have the headcount or the budget to, take care of the issues, then, you're kind of limited. So what we've actually done to help with that is develop a suite of very easy to understand and visually compelling reports that you can share with your board, with your finance committee, et cetera, which will help you make the case for why you need more resources in your IT department. So there's a lot of these. The one I'll just look at now is the board summary report. And this basically lays out where you stand as an organization on your own cybersecurity compared to the industry.
Sorry to interrupt, John. Francois just sent me a message, which I think makes sense. Would you be okay pausing so there's enough time for feedback or stopping?
Absolutely.
So
and this is basically the last point I had to make anyway, so we're not missing much. So we'll go ahead and wrap up here.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the time and I know we had quite a few people on here and I want Jonathan to get some feedback. So do you want to start, Jordana?
Sure. I mean, God, there's so much that I liked. Starting with just this ultra compelling idea of like problems with interesting names that completely piques my curiosity and I have no idea what to expect. And that is awesome. And I've never seen anything like it, quite frankly. I think it could be helpful, and I'm just going to give like a few top line pieces of feedback. I think it could be helpful to find a way to condense the number of problems down to 3 rather than 5. And I think that that it's funny, the way that you described these problems and brought me in using storytelling was really dynamic. Yet I found myself sometimes checking out as though you were talking about a series of features, in part because I think there could be more opportunities for interaction. I don't have the answers on exactly where those places are, mm-hmm. but I think interaction and conversation is going to help shortening the number of problems and making sure that the problems you pick are very tied into what you learned about what I care about in discovery. Because in absence of that, in some ways we're in feature dump land, albeit very dynamic feature dump land. So that is some of the top line problems, but so much great and interesting stuff, John, really.
Perfect, thank you.
Larissa.
Yeah, I wanna definitely echo Jordana. Number one, your product training and enthusiasm for the product definitely comes through. You love this and you know that it can solve problems and that's really palpable. And I appreciated that. Setting the stage in the beginning, the way you did the agenda, really great. Where for me, and I'm going to come at this through 3 different lenses, one as a business owner who would have to be on the receiving end of this pitch, 2, the bulk of my business, I sell SaaS as well, and then the training and consulting that goes on it, and then 3, I also train salespeople. And what I train them on is how to connect to people. mm-hmm. What was really missing for me, and I'm going to be totally blunt and direct because that's me, is there was never a time that I saw Jordana engaged in this. I'll be quite honest. It was not conversational. If I were watching this to then coach you on it, the way I agree, the 5 problems, lay high level the 5 problems and say, okay, which of those 2 resonates most with you? Yeah. And then go with those, right? There was no asking and confirming. There was no continuing to dig in around her problems and what was relevant. It's so much value in this tool that it was like fire hose, like getting lost in the value of it for me. And the second is, I know you said you would have done discovery before this. A really great thing is understanding in that discovery who this person is, what their style is, so you know what to give it to them, matching hers, right? So Jordana's really connective and gracious and all of that, maybe not so much detail for her, right? Saving the detail for next meeting when she loops in her head of IT, because that's who you've identified is the SME on this. So that's my feedback.
Yeah, I think those are all great points. And I agree with Jordana and Larissa. I think the presentation was great. I think, you know, the way that you were able to get some fun titles in there definitely piqued my curiosity. I wanted to see where you were going with it. And I definitely noticed your enthusiasm for the product as well. So props for that. I know you've been there for a short time. So that's awesome that you've been able to pick it up. I would say kind of in a similar vein as what was mentioned, but maybe just a little bit more specific moments. So for example, in the beginning, I would start with just a quick alignment on what it is that you guys have talked about so far, right? And just get her confirmation because, you know, she may or may not remember exactly everything that you guys chatted about. So just open with that, show that you are actively listening, et cetera. And then there was a moment where I think you asked the question, like, if this were to happen, would you want to know right away? And she kind of like perked up and enthusiastically said yes. And then you kind of moved on. I think that's a key moment where you can just say, oh, great, tell me more about that. Right. Or why? Like, why is it important for you to know about that right away? And have her elaborate, because the product is really cool, but you really want to get to the point of like why it matters. And then just kind of a small thing in terms of like language, and I'm sure you've heard this before, but you know, I do it too sometimes. I've tried to stop less where, you know, I've never said, is this all making sense? And had somebody say, no, I have no idea what you're talking about, right? Like most of the time they're gonna say, yeah, sure, you know, it makes sense. You know, one question that you can ask instead to get that confirmation is, for example, what do you think about that? Right. So you kind of go through your thing and then you just stop and you go, what do you think about that? And leave it open-ended and kind of let her drive a little bit. But that's all. I think it was great. But those would be like my general comments.
I like it.
Amy, you're in this world. I'm curious.
Yeah. Yeah. This was a good one for me. So, well, first off, you know, Jonathan, I'm a huge fan of you. I mean, the amount of time it takes you to learn like the in-depth knowledge of the product you're selling and the industry you're selling in is really impressive. So I always have to give you kudos for that, because no matter what, like you're a very, very good storyteller and you can tell that you're passionate, and for you to be able to evolve that quickly in a new role is seriously impressive. So I've got some very pointed marks to make. So one, you know, you set up the meeting really well, but you took a little bit too long. I'd say you could probably cut a couple minutes off at the very beginning explaining like the whole total complete layout of the call end to end. I think that's not necessary in this case. Like you confirmed you've got an hour, great, boom. The only thing I would say is say at the end of this call, the expectation would be that, you know, we move forward with the next step, whatever that may be in, you know, in your pipeline plan. The other thing I would say is I agree completely, condense it down. So on a lot of my technical demos and calls, I usually have a sales engineer, you know, that's the technical wizard and the nerd that's showing the technology. And I'm more the color commentary, but it looks like in your role, you're kind of both, right? You're the sales rep and kind of the technical guru touring them around. Is there another step beyond this that digs into the technology more, or is that you?
Yeah, so I would have a sales engineer on this call with me. In this particular outline we've seen, there's not a lot for the sales engineer to do until people have questions at the end. That's usually when the sales engineer gets more involved. And then after this, we allow them to do an actual test drive of the product, and that is almost entirely led by the sales engineer. And I'm just kind of, you know, chiming in from time to time.
Yeah, so what I would use this call more is kind of an extension on your discovery. Right. So you kind of discovered what motivated them to take this call in your discovery, pinpoint like what are some core problems that exist. But one of the things that my engineer does that really sets up the call is, one, we make sure that they know that this is an hour that they can utilize however they see fit. If they need to interrupt us to ask questions or for us to chase rabbit trails or dig into special features that are important to their business objectives, like it's their time to shine. But what she asked them a lot at the very beginning is, with your current solution, or if you had a solution, what features would be essential for you? And what ones do you not like in your current solution, if they have one? And if not, then it, you know, that's kind of a moot point, but definitely what features are going to be essential for you moving forward that you would like to see demonstrated on this call today? So that's one thing. The problems, again, agree with everyone, minimize it, because you just don't have time. Like, you're going to lose people. And like, even like, they'll be like, oh, that's cute, you know, with the cookie dough and stuff. And that is, but once you start digging into that problem, it kind of wanes and they're going to fall off a little bit. So when you're talking about those problems, you spend a little bit more time on the screen showing them some either cool slides or the product itself. I personally don't use any slides on my demos. I let the engineer keep the screen up with the product in the background while we're kind of having back and forth dialogue. That way they're not just looking at me and hearing me. They're also seeing my engineer or seeing me kind of navigating around. And it will generate opportunities for them to ask questions and be like, oh, go back to that. And what was that again? And that really kicks that demo off. And that's how you stop it from being like that, you know, because you want them involved in the process. And I will actually stop the demo and say, okay, based on what you've seen so far, you know, how does that measure up with your current solution? Or is this something that you could utilize moving forward, and tell me how you would incorporate that into your current tech stack or whatever. And they start talking and they'll reference things more specifically, I think. So, you know, other than that, I think, you know, making sure like you are so knowledgeable that it's hard to not like share that knowledge. But sometimes as a sales rep, I find like the more simplistic I am and the more conversational, the more likely they are to move on to that second, more deeper technical call, because then they're kind of at that point of qualifying it technically. This is more like understanding if the objectives, the business objectives will be met. So I think that harkening back to, you know, all of your statements on why the solution is important and how you differentiate, always tie that back to how that will help their business objectives. You know, what problem is that going to solve for them at a high level, you know, from as far as the business is concerned. That's all I would offer, but I think awesome. And then we didn't really get to see her close at the end and kind of moving on to the next step. But, you know, that's where that conversation throughout is going to really organically drive that next step, right? And you're going to know the next step is, you know, we're going to do a quotation, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, you know, whatever it may be. But kudos to you, man, because I know you kind of jump in head first and just absorb everything. And so I'm really always impressed with that. And if you can take that and just condense it down, it's gold.
Cool. Patrick, I know the cookie dough is your favorite slide, but.
Oh my God, I'm so hungry. Holy shit. Well, first of all, I have this joke with my friends where like, I'm right a lot of the time, but when I'm wrong, I'm like really wrong, like catastrophically wrong. So this could be the case here because this is super different. It's really rare you see people do sales this way. It's usually more like question-based conversational, and this is very presentation. And I almost felt like I was watching a TED talk and I wasn't in a sales presentation, which I thought was interesting. Like the amount of work you put into it must have been astronomical. Like you have all these background video cues, you have everything like to the second planned out, which was incredible. And it was super engaging. But the whole time I was just like, you said at the beginning that oftentimes when you go through software demos, it feels easy to check out. Mm-hmm. And any presentation is easy to check out of. So in my opinion, like this is just me as a buyer. If somebody did an hour long presentation on me, I would just like not pay attention. Just like period. Like no matter how good it was, like this is one of the best I've ever seen and it's so good. But I'm almost like, this would be a good like YouTube video for you to send to people that like don't know what your product has as a differentiator. Cause you did a really good job about preventing the price objection and showing how you're different from your competition and all that stuff was amazing. But the whole time I was like thinking, how could you just make this a question? Like, how could you take this entire presentation, just make it questions? And I feel like if you could do that and get people to admit what you were doing is different and to commit to you that it's like astronomically different, that it's worth the price, that would be more efficient than just telling them. Because anytime somebody tells me something, I'm always like, well, you work for the company. There's always that thing there. Again, I could be super fucking wrong. I have been very wrong. This might be like the new way to do it, but in my opinion, I wouldn't be able to follow.
I think Patrick, what I'm hearing is similar to what a lot of people said, right? Like he knows the product, he's enthusiastic. Presentation was 10 out of 10, but it just didn't feel super engaging, right? So, and I know Jordana isn't in the role of your buyer, so she may not have been able to ask those questions. So I don't think it's totally fair, but you know, I think Jonathan, you're probably picking that up from us, right? We're going, find more places to get them to ask the questions and then you tell them the answer versus like, it felt a little bit more like, a sermon versus like a conversation and not in a like condescending way, but like a TED talk, it was good, but you know,
I agree.
It wasn't boring zone out, but I was kind of going, okay, well, when do I get to talk?
Yeah.
Was what I was thinking.
Yeah, I don't think any of us were like fully zoned out because it was like, you're very compelling. But I agree. I think that if you start asking questions along the way, right, that kind of lends itself to a little bit more conversational and a little bit more of a true kind of demo type environment or type situation. You know, it's going to engage them more, and then they're going to be impressed with not only your knowledge and passion, okay, but also the fact that you're pulling them into that experience with you. I think that's key.
Larissa made a good comment there about, you know, she almost felt like the buyer didn't need to be there. And Sir Jordana made one quick comment, and please jump in. I was thinking, like, we often talk about the storytelling. I can't remember who said it, but it would have been, you know, like, here's the 5 points. Tell me which ones you want to really hear about. And then kind of like, you know, give them those nuggets of that rabbit trail of like, okay, you know, kind of keep them feeling like they're driving the narrative and having a choose your own adventure. But Jordana, please.
Well, I was just going to say, like, this is how all of my workshops start, with like the information dump that's almost like a sermon. And then through the coach that I work with and through my own thinking, I look for moments of interaction. So this, to me, to really engage people. So this to me feels like, what a friggin' amazing draft, like very strong first draft. And now it's just about editing, essentially. Right, like slicing off the unnecessary pieces and creating more moments of interaction within what you've already created, making use of so many of the ingredients that you've sprinkled in here. So I guess I'm saying that just because it's like, it's not like scrap this and start from scratch. It's just like refine, refine, refine. That's all.
I also like the idea of Patrick using this as like a recording or an open webinar for people that are like, I don't really know about this yet. Like, what the heck is this? Like, that would be kind of cool to have on as I'm doing some other things and learn about it and then say, yeah, you know what? Problem number three, that's my problem, Jonathan. Can you and I hop on a call so I can talk to you more in depth about it? Like, it could be a cool free lead gen rather than, you know. Anyway, that was just one thought.
Yeah, I would actually, sorry.
Yeah, no, you're gonna hop.
I have to hop in for 1 o'clock. Thank you so much for having me, all of you.
Sure, yeah.
Thanks for joining
us. Go ahead, Haithem.
No, I was just going to say, like, take the opportunity to, I know this is being recorded, so watch the video back and maybe just jot down like the 5 main takeaways that you want someone to get out of the presentation, and just make sure that you double down on those and try to cut down everything else.
Well, and to Larissa's point, I don't know how much inbound versus outbound you're doing, but I think what would be a really interesting outbound video would be that first slide, like, hey, this is what we offer. I compartmentalize them into these 5 things. Tell me which piece you would love to hear more about, and then send them that. And like, nobody else is doing that. Nobody else is talking about cybersecurity like cookie dough.
Yeah, it's really unique. And I can tell you, being in this space, you know, you would think that you need to be highly technical being in the cybersecurity world, and you don't. I mean, the engineers complain more to me all the time, my customers, that they hate being talked to like, you know, sales rep to engineer. Like, they hate that dynamic. They just want to have like a conversation and you to really, them to understand you really hear them. So that first slide with all the problems is like the key, because it'll hook people in and they'll be like, huh, what's this guy all about?
Yeah.
And you didn't talk about penetration testing. So, I mean, that's.
Yeah, pen testing. Yeah, for sure. I mean, that's a big deal, you know?
I don't know if that's good or bad.
You don't sell cybersecurity products, right? You just do like the overall security score assessment, right?
Correct. Yep. Just
yeah. So I mean, vendors like myself, you know, we want people to come to us with like horrifyingly scary testing scores, like, oh, help us, you know. So it's cool. I enjoyed it.
Awesome. Okay. I know we're a couple minutes over. I appreciate everybody making time. Thanks, Jonathan, for being in the hot seat. Thanks, Larissa, Haithem, Amy, Patrick, for making time. This is going to be a fun one to come up with some idea on what to post, because there was some really cool ideas in here. So my mind's kind of, yeah.
It's got to be the churning cookie dough.
Totally. Just send cookies. Send cookies.
awesome, guys. Have a great weekend. And thanks again for making time.
Thanks, guys.
Bye, guys.
See you, everybody. Have a good weekend.